Thanks again, Kim. Thank you everyone for being there. I see 30 participants up here. As you know, last week we were discussing Android considerations, meaning that this has to go mobile and offline. And during the session, I was telling you a lot of things, and I was telling you this we'll discuss next time, this will next time. So today is next time, and we're gonna be doing is discovering a bit more about what should entitle when you decide to implement DHIS2 with Android. If you remember, this is the two sessions that we did. The first left one is the one we were talking last time. And just quickly, I'm gonna remind you what we did, but basically we presented the app. I tried to explain some use cases. Then we did a briefly showcase of the app. I was explaining what are the things you can achieve by using the application. And then after all that, I basically raised the question, why should you choose Android or not? And in the end, we briefly covered some considerations, both on the server side and on the device. Today, on the right side, what we're going to be doing is discussing, once we have decided that we want to put Android in place, what do we need to be looking at a bit more deeply? And basically, we're going to cover how you should manage your fleet. By fleet, I mean the set of devices that you decide to put into place, with some tools that we can provide or that you can find yourselves. I will mention a bit what is the testing and training considerations you need to be taking care of, and then some topics that I did not know where to put them, but I think they're also very important, which are more security, SMS, budgeting, and complexity. In some of these topics, I will be linking to other sessions that will take place later this week. So don't hesitate if you have questions at the very end, raise them. If it's something that is a topic that I'm not really into, I will push you to that session. And then we have the question and answer session that we'll see if it's 15 minutes or a bit more, and maybe we will have a special guest. So jump in.
Can you put it into presentation mode?
I'm in presentation mode. You cannot see that. The thing is, if I do, you mean this, eh?
Yes, thank you.
All right. Then I have lost my speaker notes, so I'm going to be doing everything by heart. It's all right. Okay. So I already did the quick recap from last session. But what I wanted to remark again is that this is not a competition between web version and Android version. I think your projects could be using both. And what I'm trying to explain here is, okay, if you decide to use Android, this is what you need to be looking at. But again, please, not a competition, because you need to use Android and not the web, or the other way around. Both can coexist very well, but you will need to adapt your settings. And there are many things to be taken care of. For me, the very most important thing is to remember that the big difference between web-based version and Android version is that once you deploy with Android, and I'm remarking it here, your Androids are already there and you might not have your hands on them. And this we're gonna try to see it or explain in this graph, that on the left side, I have put a web version, and on the right side, I've put the Android version. And I'm saying up there, it looks the same, but it is not. And I'm saying it is not because of this. When you have a web version of the HISP, your workstations, like you can see here on the left side, are gonna be permanently connected. And then you have the DHIS2 server, and your workstations are going to be connecting either through the internet or a local area network. Doesn't really matter. But the important thing to remark is that your nodes are fully connected, or when they are operating, they need to be connected to the server through their network, whatever network, internet or LAN again. But on the right side, and this is very, very important to remark, and for you to understand, because my whole session is gonna be based on this, is that your Android devices are ready to be working offline. And that's the reason I'm calling them likely to be disconnected. Sometimes you will have internet, sometimes you might even work directly connected, but one of the big benefits of Android is that you can take them out of the field and work whenever you don't have a connection. And again, even if it looks the same, it is very different. Because for example, imagine that you want to make a little change on your DHIS2 server here on the left side. Whenever your clients would connect on the left diagram, they would immediately see the change. So you decide to change your program, you decide to make something, you want to include a new attribute, or you want to change the entry form, you change the server, the next time, almost immediately, I'm gonna say, the next time someone would open that the tracker capture application on the HIS2, boom, they will see the changes. While on the right side, because of the Android way of working, you will need to make the changes, but you will need to tell your nodes, your end devices, please, you need to update before. So again, I'm gonna be reiterating this. It looks the same, but it's very different. And because of this huge difference, you will need to redefine a bit everything, the way you work, the way you train your users, the way you decide to synchronize your devices, the need, the way you tackle from security. So the whole session today is gonna be based on this. I'm gonna try to give you hints whenever you decide to implement Android. You need to remember this picture and you say, okay, yes, because what was discussed during the Tracker Academy, I need to take into account many, many things. Oh, okay. So I've been told several times that I need to remind you the word of the day that you need to use to fill in your attendance list. So the word of the day today is immunization registry. So if any of the instructors could please kindly put that in the chat, I would appreciate it. For all the participants, please write it down. I will say it again at the end of the slides, but if you wanna put it down already. And I'm gonna continue. So again, I'm gonna show you this map. Please keep this in your mind because we're jumping into this. Managing your fleet. So you have decided to use Android, you have implemented your tracker program, and you have pushed some nodes on the field. Because they want to be working offline, I'm gonna put an example. We have some community workers that they have been given their phone. The tracker program has been properly set up. You have defined a way of entering data in a more visual way. You have some hints, you have defined all your phones, blah, blah. And the field workers are gone with these devices. They are expected to work from it. And at one point they will need to synchronize this information to the server. So when you want to send information, which is not configuration, but is real information, either from the Android to the server or from the server to the Android, we're gonna be talking about data synchronization. So you imagine your field worker has been working the whole day, and at one point he or she wants to push this information back to the server. He could come here and perform a synchronization. I will later on explain you a bit more how we could automate this, but basically by default, the application has some settings that you could change per device, and you could say, okay, I want my Android devices to communicate, to send the data every day, every half an hour, every 7 days, I think it is. And the important thing about this is that as long as you're not doing this, your information is not being sent in one direction or the other one. I'm gonna be focusing now. Let's forget of the changes you can make on the server or of the information that reaches the server already, or it's already on the server. But I wanna focus on this field worker who's there on the field working on the device. If this person is working there for a whole day, and he or she does not push this information back, either by pressing that button or because of the synchronization, because this device has no internet or not connectivity, this information will never reach the server. And again, this is completely different from your web version, where usually the moment you are entering something, immediately it reaches the server. So again, try to bring that map back to your head. Okay, yeah, because my nodes are disconnected. So because there's no communication, I need to perform this data sync. At the moment, Android does not support immediate sync. It's something we are considering, but if you do not click that button or your phone is not set up to perform this synchronization, your data would remain on the phone. And this, I'm putting here, understand the impact of this, because, and I'm gonna focus now on the last one, on data loss. Imagine your field worker has been working the whole day, the whole week, the whole month, and he or she never pushed back to the server because you did not define a proper syncing strategy, or because this phone never had connectivity. And this phone or tablet or Chromebook breaks down, the information is lost. It's lost. So when you define, as a project manager of a tracker implementer, you define these kind of things, you need to take into account, okay, what is going to be my sync strategy? Do I want the devices to sync automatically? I will need to set them up, so you need to set every device. Or I want to train my users on sending this information, so I know that every time they input something, they need to synchronize manually, or I want them every half an hour to go back to, I don't know, the point where they have internet to sync the data, etc., etc. So syncing strategy, I think when you plan your project, is something you need to consider. And also the other way around, metadata sync configuration. Before I was telling you, imagine you want to modify a program that you have already implemented. You want to include a new attribute, for example, because for whatever reason you have decided that now you need to collect this information. You make the changes on the server side. Your Android devices do not have this change unless your users could go here to sync configuration. I would click sync now. Or actually, if you have the sync configuration automatically every 1 day, 7 days, whatever it is, only at that moment, the information will be pushed to the, or will be pulled from the devices, from the server, sorry. I got distracted with the, one second, I need to mute my notifications. Okay, sorry, back to it. So I was saying that if you do not sync the configuration, the changes that are made on the server side will not be reflected on your devices. And this could also happen if your devices are out there on the wild, you have not, you have defined a plan where the field workers are gonna be without internet for a month. You have to understand that any change on the server will not be reflected unless these devices connect. So maybe you also need to include this in your training, or you need to include this in your program, or you need to include this in your workflow when making updates on the server. If you know your devices are synchronizing on the first of the month, maybe you want to make sure you make the changes at the end of the month so they can quickly pull them next time they connect. The impact of this on the server. So we discovered data loss. We have gone through it, but also in terms of server and connectivity, connectivity is basically what I've been mentioning. If depending on what's the connectivity in your devices, if they are fully connected the whole time or they're not, if they connect once per week, once per month. Of course, if there's no connectivity, you cannot perform synchronization, either data or metadata, up or down. And the server, I'm putting this, and I'm putting a burning server here. Because also in the same way, if we go back to the picture where you have here the workstations connecting pretty much every time they perform a change and you have Android, imagine that we have now 100 devices on the wild, out there on the field, and they all sync at the same time. If we could draw the distribution of server connections through time, here could be probably very, very well sorted somehow, because during working hours, people are connecting between 9 to 6 p.m., for example. But here in Android, we'll see that there's no connection, zero, because our devices do not have connectivity out there on the field. But the moment they would come and they would synchronize, we will have a huge spike of information reaching our server. And this, I know it's a bit difficult maybe to view or to see how we could prevent this, but there are strategies you could use. You could synchronize data from devices at different times, etc. But what I just want you to remember from this is that if you would have a lot of devices that they synchronize at the same time, maybe you need to consider with your system administrators a way for the server to be able to balance this a bit, or on your sync strategy to define that some devices will go back to headquarters on Monday, the others on Tuesday, the others on Wednesday, etc. Again, this will have an impact if there is a lot of information and a lot of devices sending information at the same time, but it's something that I think is worth mentioning here. It's not the first time actually that we see a project being impacted by this, but a lot of devices connecting at the same time. So now that I explained the sync strategy, you might tell me, okay, it might be a bit complicated going through every device because I have 2000 devices out there on the field and I need to specify manually when I want them to synchronize. I'm sorry, but this is too much. That's the reason we have developed what is called the Android Web Settings app. That is an application you can install on the server side. I'm putting here a screenshot. And I'm not going to cover through it. I'm not going to go through it very thoroughly. You have the manual here on the slides. But basically, what I want you to know is that this sync strategy I was explaining before, it's something that you can centrally manage from this application. So for example, here I have put in the screenshot that if you would like your devices to perform a metadata sync every day, you could come here, you could put one day, and how often should you do the data sync? Imagine you want to do every hour because you are fearing that the information is going to get lost because the field workers are in a very unsafe environment. You could set it up here, and then all your devices, the first time they connect to the server, will retrieve this information and they will apply the settings. It's not the only thing you can do from this application. You could also specify the amount of data that you want to download on the devices by programs or data sets, meaning that, for example, you are working with device with very limited connectivity, or internet is very expensive on your country or project. Here you could trick and you could say, okay, I want my devices to download a really, really small part of the information they need. Sorry, of the data, because the information needs to be retrieved. But for example, you would say, okay, my field workers are only gonna be pushing information towards the server. They don't need to have information back. So you could tell them, I don't want you to unload, for example, patients. So you will only be recording patients and then send them to the server, but I don't want to download. So like this, you could reduce a bit the data transfer between the server. Other things you could do with this application is configuration of the SMS, to put the gateway that we cover a little bit later on. And you could also decide to encrypt your devices, which is something that I explain a bit later on security. And the last option here, the user sync test, is in case you install the application, you can put a user and you can see what is the amount of information this user would download. So it's a bit for you to troubleshoot. Again, link in there the manual. So for you to read it, if this sounds interesting. But might be the case that you think that this is not enough, because actually from this management, so managing your fleet, we're only focusing on the DHIS2 part. If you would need to go a step further, you could implement or you could put in place what is called the mobile device management. And this is a really broad topic. When we do an Android Academy, it covers a whole session. So here I do not have the time, but I want to give you a couple of hints. So mobile device management, it's something, as you can see in the picture, even though it's not the best and can be a bit confusing, but here we will have the DHIS2 server, and here there is an MDM server. Just for you to know that it has nothing to do with DHIS2, so it's a completely separate thing, not the same way it was the application I presented before. This is a completely different system, completely different setup. And the goal of this is to manage your Android devices. So not the DHIS2 application, settings or configuration, but your devices. And what you can do with this MDM, among other things, is this. So for example, one of the main issues we have seen on the field, on the projects, is that we in Oslo code the application and every 6 months we push a new version, and whenever we need to release a patch, we release a patch. Unfortunately, if you have installed the application through Google Play, and your device is set up to retrieve updates automatically, you're going to be taking them. So might be the case that your devices get updated when we push a new version, and it's not something you want. So if you would have an MDM in place, you could define when you want to push this information, this new application or not. In terms of security, you could also remotely wipe the devices. Imagine you have lost a device that might contain sensitive information. It's something you could do. You could manage the specific apps. As I said before, you could distribute whatever you want. You could block applications. You could even make tablets or phones to only display the DHIS2 application. You could monitor or manage the network uses, etc. Again, MDMs, there are thousands of different products offering this. We have put some of them in the guidelines that I'm including here, down here. And as far as I know, there are three currently DHIS2 projects using them. I hope that soon we can actually have a talk or a session where they will explain it. The big drawback of this is that it might be really, really expensive. It's going to be $1 or $2 per device per month, which might be a lot, might be something that you cannot pay, but you would have to assess the cost benefit and say, okay, it's expensive, but it's something I really need because my situation is this and this and this. And if that could be the case, it's something that you should include in your budgeting and in your projects, etc. I think Anne in 2 days will talk a bit more about budgeting. So it's something that she's going to mention as well. For the testing and training, again, if you remember from last session, we were talking about the main differences between web and Android. And because of this, I think that it's really important that when you decide to use Android on your implementations, you adapt both your testing and your training. From the configuration side, I explain how could you change, for example, to make it more visual. You could put colors. You could define the different dropdowns. You need to see how it's gonna look on your if your form is gonna look nice on your device because it's much more screen. If the input it's easier to type, which is not usually, so you want to have it more interactive, more visual, etc. So all these things are things that you, I would say, must change in your configuration. If you want to have a proper user experience from the Android perspective, you need to make these changes. On the same topic kind of configuration that you need to change is the sharing settings. If you remember, and going back again to the picture, your Android are disconnected, and if you put this together with the session from last time where I was telling you Android devices are gonna take as much information as they might need in the future because they know they will be disconnected. Because of that, they're gonna take all the information that you have set up. So as a quick example, imagine you have a field worker who's only gonna be working in a child program, but you perform a bad configuration on your server and you assign to this user child program, nutrition program, TV program, AIDS program, etc., etc. Android device, the first time it connects, it will say, okay, I've been told that my user can work with this, and this program, so I'm going to take that information. So this means the user with a lot of information, which might impact on the performance of your device and on the connectivity of the device. So you need to define the certain settings, trying to adequate them to your needs. And I'm putting again program rules here because I already explained that web and Android work in a different way. So you need to define or adapt the program rules for them to be working on both sides. This will change hopefully really soon, but it's one of the main problems we see and we get requests support on. So make sure. And because of this, I'm linking down there, test. So when devices are out there on the field, it's going to be much harder for you to be able to perform these changes because you will need to change, you will need to ask them to synchronize metadata, et cetera, et cetera. So make sure you do tests. So you have a tracker program, is working wonderfully on the web version, then you decide to implement Android. Please make sure that it works really as you would. So making these tests, and then at one point, probably you want to deploy slowly, et cetera, et cetera. I'm also putting here that it's not only your configuration you should adapt, but your training, because the application might look different. If you have decided to perform or set up a bit more visual input, maybe you need to adapt your trainings for the application and also for the syncing. Syncing strategy that we were mentioning above. You need to explain the users how they should synchronize, what should they do when they have no connectivity, when they have connectivity, how are they going to be pushing this information, how you communicate with them when you are going to ask them to perform this synchronization, etc. So make sure you adapt your customize your testing and training. And now we're going with the last block, which is other considerations that I think they did not fall in another category. But basically, security, another session is gonna be covering this, but I still think it's important that I mention some security considerations once you decide to implement Android. And just for you to know, being a bit technical, we follow this directive, which is OWASP, which is a big security guide that tells you should do this and this and this. And this is one of the reasons you are not capable of taking screenshots when you're using the application, because of this security guide saying that users should not be able to take screenshots for sensitive information, et cetera, et cetera. What I want to mention here is that we have done our part in the sense that we have taken the measures that we think should be taken in terms of security, but it is not all at all. You need to make sure you do your part. And for this, again, I'm going back to the initial picture, your devices are out there on the field and they contain information. And that information might be sensitive. So you need to know that, for example, if you're working on your workstation, DHIS2, the moment you turn the computer off, if the user that could steal that computer or could jump into that computer and could not have the username and password, there's nothing he or she can do. But with the Android, because the information is not there, has been sent to the server and the workstation keeps nothing. With the Android, because the way they work, the information is there. So I'm putting there in bold, the data is on your device. I don't know if it's on or in. Well, English things. So I'm putting here some points, but there is a big discussion on this. You should really think this very, very thoroughly. But users, I think, should know this. You should base your test, your training, your syncing strategy, everything based on this. So imagine a user loses the phone or the tablet, the information is there, has not been synced. First problem, you have lost data, but also you might have exposed some patient's data, et cetera. So you need to make sure you adequate your whole implementation, I would say, on this. We try to protect the application with this. So application, I don't know if you know, but on the left upper left menu, you could set a pin. This pin is different from your phone pin, but you could protect the DHIS2 application with the pin. So you could explain your users how to do it. When you do the implementation, you could define the pin. You can force the users to put a pin, and it's not the same as the phone pin. So on top of that, you could have the phone pin, and this is something you could also use the MDM for, etc. But just for you to know that you can put barriers to try to increase that security. If your devices are lost and you realize that you will never recover them, hopefully the information was sent, so there's no data loss, but there might be data leak. So if you would have implemented a remote, an MDM, you could perform a remote wiping. And also, in case you are dealing with very sensitive information, you could encrypt your device either by using the MDM or with the Android application I explained before. So you could make your devices encrypt the application. So in case the device is lost, or stolen, nobody could retrieve the information. Other considerations, so SMS. If you remember before, I was telling you that DHIS2 can work fully offline, but also can work online via either mobile, Wi-Fi, or SMS, which is what it's listed here. So just quickly mentioning that if at one point you find yourselves in an implementation where you do not have connectivity and you're going to rely on SMS, which is something that works, you could synchronize both aggregate and tracker data. Sorry. You need to make sure that you prepare your server for this. So you need to reach agreement with telecom operations. You will need to put a gateway. And in the same way that when you use DHIS2 to send out information, SMS, for example, reminders like appointment reminders, tomorrow you have a date at 10 a.m. So you would need to set up the SMS gateway to work on the other way. So your devices, Android devices, would be sending information to the gateway that in the end will reach the server. So just mention it here. I don't want to get technical, but just for you to know that whenever you define your projects and you decide or you realize that you need SMS for the syncing, you need to make sure that you include what is the gateway, who's going to be in charge of this, what should I do for it to work, but also SMS credit. It's not uncommon, or I've seen in some projects where they implement everything and then they realize that the SMS credit, so data, so mobile credit or vouchers, I don't know how you call them in your country, they get exhausted. And then they find themselves having field workers that cannot synchronize because the credit, they have exhausted the credit and it's not been put in place the adequate means for them to get the vouchers or the credits or all this. So it's something that you need to also consider when you do the project management and the project plan. Budgeting, and we'll have a session, I think, tomorrow, the day after tomorrow. But quickly explain, whenever you decide to go with Android, you need to make sure that you include at least, and probably there are many more things in your budgeting. So you will need to procure the devices, which can be phone, tablet, Chromebook. You need to analyze what would work best on your setup. If you need, for example, keyboard, because the data encoders are gonna be putting a lot of information, maybe you wanna go for external keyboard, so you're gonna go for a Chromebook, etc. But the thing is that the same way that with, well, on in a different way that workstations are usually built to last, or they're less exposed to damages and things like this, with devices that are there on the field, probably they're going to get broken. So you need to consider that repair scores might arise. So you will need to make sure that you have spare devices because you don't want to stop the data collection. Maybe you want to have cases to protect them. Maybe you want to have spare parts, spare chargers, etc. And the same way for gadgets. If the field workers are going to be out there for a week and there's no way to charge the phone, maybe you need to make sure you list on your budget that you will be needing power banks or external keyboards or chargers or things like this. So key thing here is that it's not only the device, but probably all the other things you need to add to that, which with a workstation is not usually considered because you will buy a laptop, a mouse, and that's it. I'm bringing again back the MDM, so might be really expensive, but in case your project might need it, because whatever reason, if you could read the guidelines, you can decide, okay, really, I really need this. You have to assess the cost benefit, and despite being really expensive, might be worth. And also connectivity that I was mentioning in the previous slide, you need to make sure, bundles, that was the word I was trying to remember. You need to make sure you provide mobile data and SMS bundles, because I've seen projects that everything works very well, but in the end they realize they cannot synchronize because they don't have Wi-Fi on the facility, on the hospital, and because their data bundle is expired, or because the way of distributing these bundles is not the best, they need to wait for 3 weeks so they can get them and be able to push the information back. And if the information is not back in the server, they cannot do the analysis, etc. So make sure that you understand your connectivity and you procure the means to be able to push this information. Completely the opposite would be server rate URL. I know some projects The Ministry of Health had reached agreements with telecommunication operators. I think we talked about this last week on Friday, and someone asked a question, or on Thursday. So you could reach agreements with telecommunication operators where you will not be charged. I guess you will be invoiced in a different way, but connections through a specific URL, so your DHIS server, or SMS to a specific phone number are not charged or are invoiced in a different way. So you could forget about these bundles and distribution of this. So might be really, really interesting for you. I think is this the last? So I've talked for like 40 minutes, more or less. I have explained a bit this. And now you might say, wow, that's just super complex. I think Android is not the way to go because it entails many, many things that I need to consider. So Android, yes or no? For me, and again, back to the fight between web and Android, is not a fight. It's just something that can really, really help you create, but you need to assess the cost benefit. So benefit can be huge, because the fact that you can be out there working without connectivity or using a small device can really, really improve the data collection, data analysis, patient taking care of, et cetera, et cetera. But it's going to increase your complexity. Usually it's what happens. You add new plugins to your project, you increase the complexity. You will need to think when you do the project management about how you're going to be distributing the app. You will need to change the training and testing, as I explained, the devices, procurement. So basically, everything I have explained here, plus the showcases, Pamo did one on Thursday. I think we might have one now. But if not, you have also information in the community. You can reach to us. You can reach us. I mean, try to gather a lot of information. You will not be there doing this for the first. I mean, you will not be the first ones doing this. It's been done already before. And there's a lot of information that will help you are deciding or trying to roll out the Android tracker project. This is the very, I think, the last slide. So just to mention quickly, support, in case you think this session has been a bit overwhelming and you say, okay, I'm lost, where can I find help? So just for you to know that we're very active in the community of practice, that I'm pretty sure that most of you already know what it is, but there you can try to help, to get help by one of the mobile team members. You could also follow Jira in case you want to see what's the current status of a bug. Imagine you have found a bug. For example, now we have a very, very tricky one that someone asked about it on Thursday, about the QR code not being able to, I think it was Burkina Faso. I don't remember the name, sorry. But basically, this is a ticket that we understand it's a bug. We are trying to fix it. It's fixed, I think, already. So it's a way we try to be really transparent. So whenever bugs are found, we put them there. You can see what's going on. You could see when it's going to be released, the new version, so you can plan a bit better if you need to launch your project now or you need to tell your users to update, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
I may?
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. Just to let you know, let us know when you are ready. Adolphe is here.
Okay, wonderful. It's in the next slide. So very smooth transition. Thanks, Alice. I will give you the floor in 1 minute. And the last thing is academies. The last academy was held in November, if I remember correctly, but there also, that was the implementation one, but we also have academies for developers. We're being included more and more in different academies. So in case you're more interested, do not hesitate to reach us. I think this was put already on the last, in the last session. I'm putting it here again, so you have it. And Alice or Adolphe, if you're there, I'm gonna give you the floor. Just for the participant to know, we have the pleasure to have HISP Rwanda here, who's gonna be explaining what were the challenges or advantages or what did entitle implementing their tracker program with Android, which I think can be really helpful to put a bit of practice into the words I've been checking. And then after that, at 11:05, 11:10, whenever he's done, we will have a short Q&A session. So thank you very much, Adolphe. I don't know if you can share because I cannot see the screen. but feel free to start sharing and I will stop mine.
Okay, thank you, Jean. Yeah, I can start sharing my screen now.
Yes, you can. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. So just to let you know to all the participants, so we will have this presentation from HISP Rwanda. So feel free to ask any questions you may have on the Academy Slack channel. And Adolphe will make sure to reply to them after the presentation and also on Slack. Thank you so much. Adolphe, you have the floor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Alice and Shem, for this opportunity to share with the global community and participants here present of what we went through while implementing the COVID package, DHS package to support Rwanda to manage COVID cases throughout up to production of certificates for whoever got tested negative. Good morning, everyone. So with regards to Rwanda COVID case management, actually, of course, for any disease outbreak, so the country, the Rwanda has set put in place a coordination mechanism to support the COVID case management handling across whereby under the National Epidemic Preparedness and Response Coordination Committee put in place by the government of Rwanda. So there is a joint task force coordination mechanism that has been there to make sure that dairy works, dairy activity, dairy interventions are well coordinated. And we have the right people at the right time, including epidemiologists, those who are concerned with administration, communication, and also doing some plans. So in that very big structure put in place by then. So there is a very one of the components, data management, that where this COVID DHIS-based application belongs. And so this component, this unit is the one in charge of supporting the rest of the units with regards to data collection and availability of data in the right time. So this data science unit, of course, has as a mandate to have put in place a solution, IT solutions, to support the investigation team, support those who are entitled to do contact tracing, support the laboratory, whereby especially in the specimen collection and the lab requesting, lab test requests, and also of course to support the treatment centers to monitor or to update patient status if they are in hospitals. And also helps those who are providing rapid response, for those who are coming abroad if they have to be in a quarantine hotels. So hotels has to have a quick view of who is coming from abroad and who is not. And when that person is coming and when the results, the lab request has been done and when the results are out for a quick and fast information sharing, and also to speed up the service to the clients of the patients. So the COVID-19 case management, as I have previously presented last week, so it has it helps the government of Rwanda to manage testing of COVID cases from among the travelers coming from abroad. So you see there's a traveler locator form So this travel locator form is for only travelers from abroad. And every traveler, when they get registered, this is a self-registration form whereby informations are being filled by the client or the passenger. And automatically, the same information are shared across to the COVID registry, whereby profile informations are automatically collected. So when the passenger arrives at the airport, as you have seen in the first slide, the in charge of data collectors has tablets, the Android-based tablets, whereby they are collecting, in addition to profile information shared by the passenger, so they start collect samples and also capture lab requests so that people at the laboratory center, so they can immediately see this number of samples has been collected and this number of requests has been sent, so that from the tablets located to airports and other testing sites. So as of course, this is a holistic view, a big picture of how the COVID case management is done in the country, starting from passengers from abroad, but also providing the online research portal for share information.
Adolphe, I'm so sorry, you were breaking. Negative Would you cases. Mind repeating so the last sentence?
Yes, please. So this is, if I can say, a blueprint or a holistic view of how the COVID cases are managed here in Rwanda, whereby we have this DHIS instance collecting profile information, of course, lab requests and lab results, and also be able to provide SMS notifications or reminders to patients or to clients, and also sending some emails. So as I said, the COVID case management, they are in-country cases. There are also cases from passengers from abroad. So the passenger from abroad, since they are not in country, they use this self-service portal, travel locator form, where they are filling in their arrival details, flight, if they have been attended by any COVID before, if they have visited countries with COVID. Do you hear me? So then those information are automatically shared across to the central system. And whereby after when a client arrives at the airport or at the testing site, a field operator can easily update information related to profile if they are missing information, and also do some lab request after collecting samples at the testing site. So as I said, in the COVID case management, when passengers are coming from abroad, they have to be in some quarantine hotels, so to see the status of the residents. And of course, in the recent century, the same instance has been used by people providing social services like those who are selling tickets to attend some sports, and also those who are driving abroad. You know, Rwanda is a landlocked country, so most of goods are shipped from the eastern part of Rwanda, from Tanzania and Mombasa, Kenya, through Uganda. So we have the same instance is also helping to share information with the East African cargo drivers system to make sure that whoever is tested in Rwanda can easy information can be shared across and confirm that is a negative, COVID negative. So that's how the COVID case is managed in Rwanda. So mainly, since I'll be mainly focusing on the use of Android app, so I shall be mainly focusing on how these passengers are handled at the airport, getting sample space collection and so forth. So as you can see from this slide, actually when the passengers or citizens arrives at the data collection point or at the testing site, so the first image shows you a field operator filling information related to the samples. To the specimen collected for a given person. So the tablet is widely used in Rwanda to collect, to capture, to make the lab requests, so that some people at the lab, at the national laboratory centers, laboratory center, they can easily see this for this person, this sample has been sent and this request has been made. So as you can see at the collection site, at specimen collection site, so we have these vials with whereby this you can read T70135. This is actually the unique identifier of the person recorded by this first person in the tablet, so that when this sample is sent to a testing site or at a lab, they can easily identify a person. And the third image shows at a drive-through, so whereby the government is setting a drive-through testing on the roads. So people come with their vehicles, so they all even in public transport. So the field operators start collecting their demographic information. This is, of course, in country. They start collecting profile information. And the same tab, the same tablet, the one used first image and the third one, actually complement each other, whereby we start by getting registered. Do you still hear me? Hello?
Yes, no, sorry, we're muted. Yes, you break sometimes, but it's doable, thanks.
Okay. So then, here, what I can say, you see for the specimen, you see the code is handwritten. So actually our aim was to, if there's possible to have like a QR printer or like with this small size, so that when the old barcode printer to stick to this specimen, but that hasn't been done yet, but we were actually unable to make it local, so that at any testing site or at any pass through for every sample collected, we can easily have every specimen with a unique identifier in a barcode format, a QR code format, so that at the lab reception, whereby specimens are being collected, they can easily scan the specimen to immediately see this is the sample for a person X. So with regards to implementation, currently in Rwanda, of course, there's through the National Joint Task Force that is coordinating all implementations of this system. So the data science unit, which, so when I say data science, it's an ad hoc unit put in place to support what everything related to information gathering and IT tools. So the package is countrywide rolled out. Of course, in the public hospitals, public clinics, and private, they are collecting PCR tests, but mainly it's a rapid test that is currently being used. So, but also the good thing, the rapid test is also automatically loaded into the DHIS instance, but into a separate stage. Of course, the capacity building has been done, but as you know, during COVID, there are COVID restrictions. So we couldn't have much time the conditions were not allowed to have a face-to-face training. So we leverage on using the e-learning system to make sure that we reach out to so many data operators at the fields and make sure that the information and the skills are shared in the short time. As of this time, around 700 tablets are countrywide being used for data collection. And with regards to PCR testing, only 8 labs are certified, but some and sent to these 8 PCR lab testing sites. But most of the time, the people rely on this rapid test, and PCR is only for people who are willing to, who are planning to travel abroad. So far, the package is, the system is enabled with SMS. So every lab request done, the SMS is being sent. So whether the lab specimen, the lab request is done from the Android, from the Android tablet or from a web, from a PC, so the SMS is automatically sent to a client, to the person with the unique identifier and the unique identifier of who identifying him or her in the system, so that unique UID is going to be used in a combination with the phone number to check from that portal the status, the test status. Of course, the testing, the PCR tests are, and the rapid tests are paid. So the government of Rwanda wanted to have an online payment, but also there's also cash payments. So, but this also is also integrated into that COVID case flow management. And in addition to that, a certificate portal, and a certificate portal and also application has been also put in place to facilitate travelers and citizens who are willing to get certificates of their negative tests downloaded. So maybe here what I can emphasize on is that at this moment, to minimize that movement of people visiting health facilities and visiting the health centers, so people are encouraged to use online portals to directly download themselves the portal, the certificate. Of course, in addition to that, you know, when you develop the certificate, you know, they are kind of these forgery documents where people can easily start trying to forge some documents. So an Android application has also been developed and shared with the airport agents to make sure that anybody presenting a certificate, so they can easily scan it and identify whether it's a genuine document or it's a fake document. So that was also what has been completed so far with regards to supporting supporting COVID case management and response. So this is a kind of a screenshot of these portals. as you can see, there is a COVID-19 test results portal. This is where any citizen or anybody who has been tested here in Rwanda can go and browse and use his UID provided by the system and easily access the certificate. And you can see the photo has been updated to capture also vaccination status. As you know, the vaccination has been started here in Rwanda. And of course, there's also a self-testing, self-registration form for those who are planning to get tested, so that this has been put in place in a way of managing the queue for COVID-19 testing. So this is a picture of a portal, how it looks like. A person come with has to have the phone number used during the registration and also the unique ID provided by the system. This unique ID is the one they put on the vial of specimen. So the unique ID is used across in any service rendered to a COVID person tested in the country. So this slide shows you a format of a certificate, one of the certificates produced from the system through this digital certificate print application. Since this one has been requiring people to come to health facilities or to testing site to collect, so the app is not so often being used at this moment because people are much better with using the portal, probably accessing, visiting a nearby neighbor to directly they can see the results and also be able to generate their certificates if the result is negative. So as also said, this is how the certificate is being scanned. So there's an Android app developed that is actually installed on people. So this app might be public, or it might be, so whoever can use this app to see it, to check if this is a genuine certificate. So that through this QR code, so the app scans and see if the variables matches, so they can easily display, as you can see here on the left, the information for this person. So without so that if the information displayed in the app is not corresponding to the information on the paper certificate, so that means this certificate is not genuine. So so based on the in-country regulations or related to fake documents, use of fake documents, so rules and regulations can be applied and so forth. So with regards to lesson learned while implementing this DHIS Android app in COVID case management and response, so we have realized that this Android app actually simplifies the process and speed up the services. So this is very understandable. If let's say you have a paper-based system whereby papers have to be collected at the site and they are sent with a specimen to the lab for testing when the results are released, so the results are ready, so they are maybe the paper sent back and so forth. To find that with this Android app, people can simplify the process and also speed up the service. With this Android app, you can easily do your service online, offline. So especially, you know, sometimes the vaccinations are happening in the remote sites where there is not necessarily at the health facilities. And you find maybe in the stadiums, in the identified wide, you know, to keep this social distancing. So you find they need an area where they have a very big space to make sure that people coming for testing, they keep social distancing in this COVID rules. So you find the use of tablets, the use of Android app helps to do your service offline, even in the area with limited internet, to, as we have seen, for example, at the pass-through, whereby on the road, the Rwanda Biomedical Center, the Ministry of Health can set up a pass-through testing site with the field operators, those who are taking specimens, those who are registering people. So you find in that area, it's not easy to find an electricity. It's not easy to find, let's say, a site with it. Every site may not have a good internet. So relying to the tablet, you can easily register your person. And also, while taking sample, the offline functionality helps you also to do a lab request. Mm-hmm. So when those lab requests automatically, since the system is centralized, those lab requests can easily be shared with the national testing labs. So using also the Android app, we have like that, it's more flexible and adds a kind of portability. So, you know, it's very difficult to find, let's say, a laptop of, let's say, of battery autonomy of more than 4 hours. Huh? But with the tablet, so you can have a tablet that has power autonomy of, let's say, of 12 hours or above. So with the Android app, as I said, you can easily label your specimen based on UID from the system, because you have the tablet that helps you to directly interact with your system. You have a copy of your system at your fingerprint. And of course, as I said, it helps you to improve the follow-up and tracing of tested people. The other information to share here, we found even though the screen size seems to be like something that people may pay attention a lot, but any Android handset with the version 7.0 works well, whether it's a tablet, whether it's a phone. So we have seen so many situations where tablets may not work well, but you find phones works well. But here comes in security concerns. So when it comes to where people are using the individual phones, you find, you know, with the DHS Android app, you are syncing with the central database, which means you are pulling all information from the system to your phone. So you find in that situation, there might be some ethical considerations and data security issues. But in terms of data collection and supporting or speeding up the process, it's good to use this DHS tablet.
Hey, Adolf. We're running close to out of time, so could you wrap up in the next 2 minutes, if possible?
Yes, possible.
Thank you very much.
So we have also seen it's almost always advisable to sync data and the configuration to make sure any changes in the system is automatically reflected to users' tablets. If this is not done, so it's be a challenge and might also contribute to data loss. Of course, we have also seen that you need to optimize your user management, making sure that data collectors have not a very big, a wide access to, let's say, to the national level, because it affects the loading time of information and also may contribute to a failure during synchronization. These are some of the challenges. Of course, you need to mind of the budget for internet bundles, because every morning, data operators need to make sure that they sync with the national central system, but also at the evening to make sure that they are pushing data onwards. The other maybe challenge that I can share with you as of now, it's not easy to trace the sync errors. So whereby, for example, you have a given number of users using the Android app, so you can't easily know this user is facing this and this and this, and you find the errors on the user's tablets, and they may not have internet, so troubleshooting, helping users might be a problem if you don't have a skilled person on site. And with using this Android app, it may not easy to identify any data loss, especially we see people saying, okay, we have this, I have this number of data on my case on my tablet, but we're checking from the system, I can see only few have been, I can see few cases have been synced. So without knowing that, maybe somehow failed. So you find it's not easy to find where the problems is in some cases. Also, we found like when you start loading and maybe find the loads unending, so you find it's not easy to stop the process. So I think that's what I can say with regard to challenges. And this PowerPoint is going to be shared with you for if I have skipped some or not briefly extend a little bit to some of these challenges, but we can still exchange on Slack. That's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your time and the consideration. Hope to hear from you if there are questions. Clarification needs it. Thank you. Over.